You Nation, welcome back again. I'm here with Pastor Jeff, Nate.
Hey.
Curcio here. We're just enjoying this conversation about your adventure with God. On the very first week, we talked about how knowing God is an adventure, not a formula. And then last week, we established that relationships are a choice and not an accident. Now today, we're going to talk about how to learn to share our own stories of faith. But before we dive into that, let's have Pastor Jeff pray.
Right. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you that we can be together. We can study the word. Thank you for the adventure that you have us on. Lord, please be with us today. Help us to focus on you and be able to share our story and listen well to others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So we all love stories.
I do.
Right? I mean, youth particularly love hearing a great story. But I got a question. What makes a great story?
Just like in general, what makes a great story?
But then after that, okay. You know, I want to know what makes a great story of faith. So we're going to like head in that direction. But
I think for me, I've heard some missionary stories, all of those things. But what makes a missionary story great is when the outcome is all but certain. Like, you know that they're going to get hurt, or you know they're going to not have the supplies they need or whatever. And then all of a sudden, it's there, you know, by a miracle. So when the unexpected happens, when the person serving God gets that huge blessing that was not expected, or they stepped out in faith when they knew something bad was going to happen. So all of those things, when the unexpected happens, or when something happens that you didn't think was going to, and it's a miracle. So those stories of faith build you. And when you can relate to them, when I can see them, it's be like, oh, that's where I could be in the story. And that's hard sometimes.
Yeah, I'd say kind of similar. I feel like the thing that makes most stories good is the same thing that I think makes friendships good, and that's just when you connect with the characters. So whether it's a story from a friend that's sharing it, if it's a friend, like, I'm probably going to be relatively interested in what they're sharing because I'm connected with them as a character. Mm-hmm. If it's a story that I'm reading just like in literature or something like that, I'm just thinking of some of my favorite stories. The ones that I like, it's because you connect with the character and you usually care about like the obstacle they have to overcome. If their obstacle is like something, you know, not very interesting, like, I don't know how to make pasta. Like, it's just like, I might care about the character, but I may not care about their story.
Some people might. Right. Story about them.
They may. But typically, you connect with the character and you care about the obstacle that mm-hmm. they, you know, it's framed in a way. You get to know the character well enough to realize, like, it's important for the character to overcome this thing. Mm-hmm. Whether it seems small or big, you understand the character enough to realize for this particular character, this is important for them. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I'd say, how about for you?
I would have to say a happy ending.
So romantic ending, no.
Well, you know, especially when it comes to faith, right? Because that's where we're going. And we're going to talk about an amazing story of faith found in Mark chapter 5 here in a sec. And the idea is, for me, when someone exhibits faith, and they get rewarded for it, mm-hmm. you know, and not always rewarded in the sense of getting what they want, but something that helped them grow spiritually, something that highlighted, hey, God is involved and in control, to me is one of those like amazing moments in a story. And it's still a happy ending, even if it doesn't exactly pan out the way that the protagonist wanted it to, right? So in Mark chapter 5, Nate, tell us a little bit about what's happening in that story.
This is a really cool, story. I know some of you guys are tracking along in this Bible reading plan. If you haven't, if you're not doing that yet, we want to encourage you, hop on. There's different ones going on, I know. But the one that I'm involved with, we've read through Mark, and I remember reading this story not too long ago.
Yes.
Of the story of Jesus going across the lake, and it's been a rough night because he's already had a storm mm-hmm. on the ocean, mm-hmm. and he's calmed the storm with his words, and then he gets over to, like, the shore, and then there's another problem. It's just like problems are following him constantly. Mm-hmm. The problem is a demoniac, a demon-possessed person, which is scary as anything in my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely.
Charges them. He charges at him, and other gospels would tell us there were actually two of them, right? Mm-hmm. But, I mean, this description, I'll read it really quick here. It says that this guy, he had been dwelling among the tombs, which is really morbid, mm-hmm. and no one could bind him, not even with chains,
that means they've tried. Like, it's not just this happened last night and then Jesus showed up to fix it. Like, no, they tried to chain him. They've tried to restrain him, to get him away, and no, it wouldn't work. So this has been going on.
It says that the shackles and chains had been pulled apart by him, and no one could tame him. it says. And so it says, always day and night, he was in the mountains and in the tombs crying out and cutting himself with stones. And so you get this like picture. It's terrible. Like you get the, like, I appreciate what you said, because you get the idea, like, people know not to go to this spot because these guys can't be controlled. And so you can just imagine people, it says that they tried to tame him, they tried to chain him, tried to do these things, and they couldn't. So you can imagine the next best thing, if we can't help change a bad situation, a lot of people just avoid it. And so you can just imagine people in the community being like, I don't know what their names were, but like, hey, there's Steve and Charles, and like, their story's done. You know, like, that's them. We've tried to tame them. We tried to work with them. We've tried to restrain them. Neither of those things worked. And so you can just imagine people writing their story as finished. Like, that's it.
Also, what's going on? We don't know what's going on mentally. The only clue when that's happening for him, the only clue we get is how much he realized things has changed in a moment when he's healed. He knows what had happened in a minute ago. And so there has to be something going on in his mind that he's done himself. Like, he's writing his own story is done. Like, there's no hope. And I felt like that before, like, what I've gotten myself in, maybe he was messing around with something he shouldn't have been messing around with. Maybe, I don't know his story from before. Maybe somebody, I have told this story before, but somebody else was messing with something they shouldn't have been, and it impacted somebody else's life. Like, that can happen. Sure. Like, a drunk driver, is it not your fault, but you may end up in a car accident because of that drunk driver. So I don't know his story, but he could have easily written himself off. Like, we've all been there where we think, I can't get out of this.
Yeah, I think there's so many points when we hope that we're not defined by a moment that we're in. I know, like, for example, you know, we've been going through COVID here. My kids haven't been back to church until like this last Saturday. We brought them to church for the first time to go to Sabbath school. We were all excited about it. Everyone's happy in the car, but it's pouring rain when I arrive at church. And so I'm trying to get one of my daughters, I have like a bag of groceries because we're donating to people in need at our church anyways. So I'm carrying like a bunch of donated items to give to the homeless shelter. And then I have my two-year-old, I'm like pulling her like as fast as I can because it's raining. I don't want her to get wet. So like in my heart, I'm trying to do this so she doesn't get wet. But then she falls down in the parking lot and is like screaming. And like a family walks by and I'm like, and that's the snapshot that they have of our family. I'm like, man, this is not accurate. Like, we've been so happy this morning and stuff. Like, this is not an accurate snapshot. So that's like a simple example. But I think all of us have like these snapshots of, it's just like, man, I hope that this isn't what defines my life for the rest of my life. And sometimes we can wonder, is it? Is life ever going to get better than this snapshot? In the story, I mean, finish the story for us, Kirstie.
Well, no, like,
there's good news to it.
Oh, absolutely.
Except for the pigs. But the pigs.
Not what happens with them, I mean, but, you know, but the idea is Jesus heals him, right? He casts these demons out. It's amazing. You know, Jesus says right there in verse 8, come out of this man, you impure spirit. And, you know, it's just amazing to see how this demoniac's faith to come before God. And the truth is, he wasn't even speaking, requesting to be healed. But
heart,
evidently,
Jesus
read his heart and gave him the desire to of his heart, which was to be freed from these impure spirits, right? And then here's the thing that catches us, and this is where we want you to pay close attention. Jesus tells this man to turn around and share his story with others. You know, he wanted to be a disciple. He wanted to follow Jesus.
He didn't even, he followed him to the boat and he begged him. He's like, please let me come with you.
And Jesus was like, nah, I need you to stay here and share your story. And then later on, when Jesus comes back to the area, you know, this man served as a mouthpiece for Jesus.
Which is really important to understand, because as you guys mentioned, the demons go out of this guy into pigs, and the town people
hate it.
They look at the cost of, was it 200, 2,000?
2,000
dead pigs,
yeah,
bloated on the water, floating there, and two healed people. They do the math, and they say, no, transformed lives aren't worth this cost, so they ask Jesus to leave.
That's correct.
And
that's
so it makes sense why Jesus asks him to stay, because he's like, okay, my power of changing lives isn't working, but if they can spend more time with a changed life in the presence of you, if you can share what this means to you, maybe when I come back, they'll want it too.
Well, and just like you were saying, we don't always get what we want. Like, we want healing, like the demoniac wanted healing, and he wanted to be free of the demon, but then he wanted to go with him, and Jesus is like, no.
Yeah.
So we think we know what we need, right? And it's not always. We just need to keep walking and keep adventuring with God.
So think about this, guys. Your story is still in progress. It's not complete. I mean, think about the demoniac. His story was not complete. He may have thought, this is it.
This is it.
Like, I'm always going to live with these impure spirits. It's going to be the death of me. Mm-hmm. But instead, Jesus had another plan.
Well, he may have thought, this is it too. I'm going to follow him. Nope. Jesus right.
Exactly.
Right.
So we encourage you to pay attention to what Jesus is doing in your life, because your story is not complete. It's still in progress. Mm-hmm. Just continue to walk closely with him, and he's going to get you to where he wants you to be.
And we encourage you guys to share your story, because it's so encouraging mm-hmm. for you to share your story with others, because someone else might be in like one of those snapshot moments that they wish they could get up from. And it's so inspiring and encouraging to hear, like, if you can share a story like, hey, I've been there before, I've been in a place mm-hmm. like that before, yeah. but I'm telling you, Jesus is in my life, and I didn't stay there. Mm-hmm. And so wherever you're at in your story, we encourage you guys to share it with other people, because it's inspiring. It's so hopeful to be able to do that.
Yeah. Yes, it is. So Nate, you want to pray for us?
Absolutely. Lord, we thank you for being the author of our stories. Thank you, Lord, for promising to write a good ending. As long as you're in our life, the ending's great. We already know that. Mm-hmm. And so, Lord, help us to approach life like that, realizing that the pages between where we are now and the pages of our final story, we don't know what they look like, but we know that it's going towards something really, really good. Amen. So for anyone here who's needing hope, needing to realize that you can continue to lead beyond where they're at right now, Lord, let that hope hit their hearts. And Lord, help us to share our stories with others. Amen. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. See you next week, guys.
See you guys.
Blessings.
Take care. Ya.